This financial resolution and deposit insurance bill is one bill which has not been debated adequately. I read almost all the financial newspapers every day, and there has never been an attempt to have a critique of the bill. Today we had three speakers speaking on different aspects of the bill, including Mr. Swish Rai saying that, yeah, internationally there are bills like these, many countries have adopted this bill. So apparently he does not see any problem with the bill. But I look at it slightly differently. Why at all you require a bill like this in this country? I have gone into some documents which probably others have not had access to, normally you do not get access to, which document is called the confidential documents which is available to some of the privileged members of the parliament. And many questions have been raised by the members of the parliament which has been already replied to them, and I have had a look at it. Now, the other countries and Indian economy, Indian banking system should not be compared is my position, which Priya also touched about. India is an economy based on savings. Japan has a negative interest rate. For saving money, you have to pay interest there. Here, 86% of the deposits are from the small depositors. And in spite of so much of fear created during the 2008 crisis, there was no run on any bank. Why? Because people have that faith that the public sector banks especially will not fail. The State Bank of India Act has a provision that State Bank of India can never be liquidated. So today people have that confidence that once I put my money, it will come back to me. But here you are bringing in a new concept based on the Western concepts which have also failed. 2008 financial crisis, the so-called so big banks could not survive. The government only had to come and rescue them. Here after that, how this origin has taken place is in 2009, the G7 countries meet. It is their decision, not the G20 decision. G7 countries meet, they promote a board called the Financial Stability Board. Then they call the G20 countries and tell them that you do what this Financial Stability Board says. And the Financial Stability Board comes up with an idea called key attributes in which all this bill draft itself is made. Later on our people have worked on it. There was nothing, I think, to work. Because if I look at the complete detail of key attributes and the draft of the bill, it is all cut and paste. Most of the clauses are cut and paste, nothing new. Now you are bringing in a concept called bail-in, as Mr. Swish was also explaining. Bailout is a situation where a bank is going to fail, the government comes to the rescue of the bank. That's what in this country also has happened. It is what that happened with the cases of some of the banks in the US. They allowed some of the banks to die, but other banks they saved. In the bailout, the government brings in its money to save the bank so that the economy does not collapse and the depositor also gets back some of the money. Here in bail-in, the total responsibility is shifted to the depositor. If the bank is not doing well and it is going to fail, because we have given all the loans to few corporates, 11,536 corporates, we have lent 37.8% of our advances. And those fellows don't pay and the bank fails, the liability will be on this poor depositor. The depositor's money will be converted into an equity. Whether that equity will ever get back is a big question. And there is a classic example. In 2013, in Cyprus, a similar situation came. While this bill has been already passed and that system is already working, the depositors got only 47.5% of the deposit they deposited. The rest all was gone. Can this country afford that situation? Can we put this problem on the heads of small depositors, lot of them pensioners, lot of them women? Small amounts they collect and put it in the bank. And if they are not going to get back in the name of liquidation, that is going to be dangerous for this country. That's why Priya was saying that we should go to the depositors, mobilize their support also. Now, comrades, why at all we talk about liquidation? Can you liquidate State Bank of India in this country? 40 crore depositors, 40 crore accounts State Bank of India has. Can you say that State Bank of India is not doing well? It has given to big corporates, now they are not able to recover the money, so State Bank of India can be liquidated. Remember? This not happened earlier also after 1969. After that, we have not allowed any bank to fail. Even the Global Trust Bank, when it was to be liquidated, it was taken over by the Oriental Bank of Commerce. New Bank of India was taken over by the Punjab National Bank. But here, you are saying that question of liquidation itself will put a mistrust on the bank. People will lose that confidence that my money will come back once you tell the people that this is what is possible. And what will happen? You will call a corporate who must have been one of your own defaulter also. He will take over this bank. Liquidation will not happen. It will be only taken over by a corporate, maybe Reliance, maybe Ambani's or Adani's or Tata. Somebody will take over this big bank. It can never be liquidated. And this resolution authority will have that power. It will do everything and then only report to the parliament. There is a clause in the bill which says that this authority, though it does not have the authority of CVC, CVA, they can ask CBI, CVC, everybody to obey their order, and they will use them for a resolution, for an investigation. And when an investigation is started, the resolution authority can tell the bank that stop your operation from tomorrow. We'll do the assessment. That assessment should be completed within a month. And then who will approve that recommendation? A judicial magistrate at the district level. What he will know about the banking sector? He will decide whether this report can be implemented. Then you go in for the resolution. That is a very dangerous thing. If you recall, 2012, when the Banking Regulation Act was amended, creating a provision for merger, we went on one day strike and then we forgot about it. Nobody thought that merger is going to come, but today it has become a reality. The same way this bill, in the arguments what they are saying, that these are all provisions already there in RBI Act, PFRD Act, Insurance Act, State Bank of India Act, all that we have combined together and we are bringing a mechanism which is going to be a super mechanism with absolute powers, which is absolute power corrupts absolutely this. That is the biggest danger we have in this bill, is my opinion. We have been discussing with the members of the parliament who are in the 30-member joint parliamentary committee. As soon as this bill was to be introduced in the bill, in the parliament, I met some of the opposition leaders, including Mr. Raghunath. I had a 40-minute discussion with him. That time he was questioning. He had a good analogy. When we said that we have an apprehension that this is all steps towards privatization, He was saying, if the defense of the country can be managed by the government, why not the finances of the country? Why you cannot continue to have the public sector, was his question. I appealed to him that you please ask your people to oppose this bill, and they opposed it when at the introduction stage. Then he asked me to meet Mr. Veerappa Moily, who is the standing committee chairman for finance, with an apprehension that this bill will be referred to the finance standing committee. They did not want that. They want it to be somehow passed. So they have recommended it to a joint parliamentary committee where the head of the committee is Mr. Bhubendra Yadav from Ajmer, who is a ruling party member of parliament in Rajya Sabha. I have repeatedly written to him asking for an opportunity to present our views to the parliament standing committee. Till now I have not got a reply. I have asked him for an appointment through some of our friends in the ruling party. He has said that, openly he has told some of our friends, my responsibility given is that I should somehow get this bill passed. So what is the use of meeting your people and listening to them? I am going to get it passed. And the same thing Mr. Veerappa Moily also told me when I met, that if this government wants to get it passed, they will push it through, we cannot stop it. So what steps I am trying is, these are people like Modi and Priya. They have worked on this bill and they have also submitted their suggestions to the joint parliamentary committee. From AIBOC, I have submitted a detailed presentation to them that is supposed to be a privileged document which I am not supposed to circulate. So I have not circulated. But our effort next is that once the parliamentary standing committee's draft is ready, I have already discussed with some of the members of the parliament that they should submit a dissent note, which they are authorized. So there will be a dissent note, and then subsequently if it is brought to the next session of the parliament, that's what they are wanting to do. We will ask some of the members of the parliament to oppose it in the floor of the house. Ask for amendments. That's why we have invited some of the opposition leaders like Mr. Sharad Yadav, who will be coming late for the next session. So that time, we want the entire opposition party to oppose this. And if that does not happen, and still the bill is passed, we are already discussing with some of the top lawyers of this country how to challenge that again in the court of law. Because there are certain things in this bill which is against the constitution itself. Constitution says that you cannot pass a bill which will take away the rights of some people. And here you are taking away the rights of the savings bank depositors. So that is unconstitutional, is my argument. Similarly, in the bill they are creating a mechanism which they say that cannot be, their decision cannot be changed in court of law. Who can take away the authority of the law? Can you take away the authority of a judiciary? But they are creating a clause. Today, in the draft bill, that clause is there. That these decisions of the resolution authority cannot be challenged in the court. That is the last refuge you have. You can go up to Supreme Court challenging any decision. But that itself, they want to take it away. So comrades, here this bill is, in my understanding, and the understanding of many of the people who have worked on this bill, is that the attempt today made is only to see that the privatization can take place without any direct intervention of the parliament. The resolution authority, after making the decision, they will just send the recommendation to the parliament for approval. By the time damage is done, today, in this country, which is a democratic country, people have their views to be told. But the standing committee, joint parliamentary committee, is not even willing to call you for a discussion. And whatever discussions are taking place so far is with the Reserve Bank of India, with DFS. Who have drafted the bill? And Reserve Bank of India, of course, in their comments, they have said that you cannot take away the authority of the central bank. Because they are also seeing that their authority is being taken away. But in spite of that, this bill is being forced on the parliament, and if it is passed, maybe it will take 1 or 2 years for them to really take action on the bill, action on the act. But that will pave a way for the government to decide that any bank can be liquidated, including the RRBs. 14,000 branches, and they have a large network to the rural areas. They mobilize a lot of deposit from the common man. Even RRBs can be liquidated. Cooperative banks can be liquidated. Public sector banks can be liquidated. And now they say that LIC can also be liquidated. LIC was started with just 5 crore investment from the government. Today, 26% of the budget for the government is being financed by LIC of India, because they are flooded with so much of money. They are investing in every bank. They have 9% shareholding in State Bank of India. In some of the public sector banks, they have shareholding up to 16%. Many of the public sector undertakings, they are having the holding. That way, they are helping the government. And however you can think of or even imagine of talking about liquidation of LIC of India. Today, their repayment rate is much better than any of the private insurance companies. Similar is the case with the General Insurance Corporation. So all these institutions, now they are wanting to bring under one umbrella authority called the Resolution Authority, which will have absolute power, which is dangerous for the country. And as we have been talking about earlier also, today the entire economic criteria is based on a policy called the Chicago School of Thought or the Milton Friedman School of Thought, which talks about minimum role for the government. The government's role is to look after the border. The government's role is to look after the taxation and the law and order within the country. The rest of it, they say that it has to be kept handed over to the private sector, because in their understanding, the private sector is more efficient. Now you see whether, in your own eyes, whether private sector is really efficient. Come to the banking sector itself. Global Trust Bank, that man was awarded Best Banker of the Year award. Next year, it collapsed. It had to be taken over by Oriental Bank of Commerce. Many of the private sector banks died. That is why nationalization was brought in. So in my understanding, within this country, we already have a robust resolution mechanism. You have just started the IBC and the NCLT. You have not even tested it. And it is unfortunate that the first case which was settled by NCLT, the amount got back by the lenders, the bankers, is just 6% of the outstanding. So it is whether it is going to help the depositor, whether it is going to help the banker or the defaulter, that is a big question. So these mechanisms we have to look at in an overall picture. What is the ultimate goal with which these are brought in? That is why we have to oppose this bill. We will take all of the efforts, and we have to see that the public sector banks remain as public sector. Now let's look at Turkey, what has happened. A new man took over. He has dismissed 1,56,000 public sector employees. He has dismissed 5,000 academicians. from the regular job, and he is looking into a new kind of a world based on the same theory of free motion, that he will give everything to the private sector and they will manage. So that is very dangerous for this country. So I would like you to please read the materials we circulate, discuss with the people, discuss with the customers, and tell them the dangers. Then the larger majority of this country, let them take the decision. With this, I conclude. Thank you. Thank you, Ananda.